Well, good morning and welcome to worship. Glad to see you all here this morning. Please stand with us as we begin.
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still and striving cease.
People said, Amen. You may be seated. Good morning. It's great to see everyone out this morning. And what a great day as we gather together as a church here at FBC. And it is an exciting day as we are going to be celebrating the baptism of a couple of our young ladies, celebrating communion. We have, the combined service, everybody gathering together. But then afterwards, we have a luncheon. Everyone's invited for that. And then we have our members meeting after that. So it's going to be a full day, great day, a wonderful day of coming together and celebrating the death, burial, resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. If you are our guest, thank you for coming out, worshiping together with us here today. And for those who are watching online, we welcome you as well. We look forward to when you can be with us also. If you are our guest here present, you're welcome to stop at our Welcome Center. We have a gift for you, thanking you for choosing to worship with us. I'd like to call your attention to our worship folder here. And we have a digital bulletin. It has all this information. It has a QR code there. And you can see that again out at the Welcome Center also. Just take your phone and log in that way. And you can carry the worship folder really with you all week on your device. But a couple of announcements we want to highlight. First of all, we have parent-child dedication coming up on Mother's Day. Looking forward to a great day. If you would like to participate in that, the details are there. Take note of some of the other events coming up. We would like to have some volunteers for our Center Shot ministry. That's this summer. We're going to host a Lincoln Community Center. We need some folks who would be able to serve. Details are there. There will be a training coming up, so we need you to sign up if you are available to do that. And again, you don't have to be an expert or even have experience at archery. We'll teach you, we'll train you, but a wonderful outreach for us into the community. Then also, I'd like to highlight the Save the Date coming up, and that's the mental health workshop or seminar. We're entitling it God's Thoughts on Your Thinking, and that's May 22nd coming up. So take note of that, and we'll have sign-ups for that as well. Again, thank you for being here. Just a wonderful time together as a church family here at FBC. Let's commit our time to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great day. We thank you for all that we have in Christ, as we sang earlier. We sang the gospel, and because of the gospel and our salvation, we can come to you through Jesus' name. And so I pray, God, that hearts would be open, and this would be a time of celebration, a time of rejoicing, and we're just so excited as to the testimonies, commitments, and baptism of these young ladies who are following in obedience to the Lord in baptism and becoming a part of our church and ministry. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, today is an exciting day, and as Pastor mentioned, we have some baptisms here. Two young ladies are coming to be baptized this morning. Baptism is a picture. It's an illustration of what has already happened in their hearts, and we're going to get to hear from their testimonies. In Matthew chapter 28, it's also a command. Jesus commands us to go and make disciples and baptize them. And then in Acts 2, we see when people believed the word, they were baptized and then added to the church. So this is a whole church event this morning. If you're a member here, this is an important part of what we do here as a member. And these two ladies will be joining our church also and asking for us to hold them accountable, help them walk with Christ. And another way it's a whole church event is that the two ladies that are coming this morning are their families have been discipling them, and I'm so thankful for the opportunity to interact with their families. I'm in one of those. But the other thing is we have some servants here that operate and teach in our children's ministries, and both these young ladies were served well by two other women in our church who shared the gospel with them, and that's when they trusted Christ. You're going to hear that first. So this morning we have Kate Beeman, and she's going to come, and we're going to hear her testimony.
Hi, I'm Kate Beeman. I was 5 or 6 years old when I got saved. I remember Miss Joanna explaining to me what saved really means. I also remember me accepting Jesus into my heart. I accepted him because I know I have sin in me, and that is why I am here today. I want to be baptized so I can obey the Lord's instructions.
All right, Kate, is that your testimony?
Yes.
You believe Jesus died for your sin, was buried, and rose again?
Yes.
All right. Well, because of your profession and in desire and your desire to be obedient to the Lord, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, and raised to walk in newness of life. Almost got that one messed up. Praise God. Next, we have Alexis Stiltner. Come on in, Alexis. This is these two are buddies, so it's cool that they're doing this on the same day. All right, Alexis, let's listen to your testimony.
Hi, I'm Alexis Stiltner, and I wanted to get baptized because I believe that Jesus died because of our sins, and when he died, he got buried in the tomb, and 3 days later, he rose again. I remember when I got saved, I was in Gopher Buddies, and my mom, I asked her about it, and she talked to Miss Misty about it, and when I was talking to her, Miss Misty helped me get saved.
All right. That's your testimony? That's you up there?
Yes.
Yes. All right. Fantastic. Go ahead and grab my arm. All right. Well, because of your desire to obey God and because of your profession of faith, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life. Praise God. Let's continue to worship, Jeremy.
Amen. Let's stand and celebrate through music this morning.
are my shepherd, I shall not want. You make me lie down in green pastures. You lead me beside the still waters. You restore my soul. No.
We are humbled by your love. We're undeserving of your love. You loved us and sent your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. You demonstrated your love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And again, we don't deserve that. And yet that's your character. That's who you are. And as you have poured your love out upon us, may we respond. May we respond from our hearts in love for you and love for others because of your grace and to your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Yesterday at Men of Faith, Alan Massey shared a story with us. This man went to heaven, and he was taught, Peter greeted him at the pearly gates. And at the pearly gates, Peter said, "Well, we'd like to welcome you, but I just have a question for you. Did you do anything good down there on earth?" And the man said, "Well, yeah, I can actually think of one thing." "Oh, well, tell me about it," said Peter. And so the guy said, "Well, I pulled into this gas station, and there was this young lady that was being harassed by this biker gang. And so I just couldn't take it. So I ran up to the biggest, baddest dude. It seemed like he was the head of the whole thing. And I ripped off his leather jacket, and I grabbed his nose ring, and I peeled it off, and I punched him in the face, and I kicked over his motorcycle and kicked the other guy's motorcycle, and I just tried to clean him out." "Whoa," said Peter, "that is really something else. Well, when did that happen?" "Oh, about 1 or 2 minutes ago." Well, as impressive as that might seem, we've been learning throughout the book of Hebrews that any adherence to the law would never make you good enough to accomplish any standing before a holy God. And that's why you and I need a Savior. We've been singing about our Savior today, His love for us. I just quoted in my prayer that God demonstrated His love for you, and that while you were yet a sinner, Christ died for you. You don't deserve it. That's called grace. We don't deserve His salvation by any means. We need a Savior, and that Savior is Jesus. And so Hebrews continually shows that He, Jesus, is better than the angels, starting back at chapter 1. We're getting ready to wind down in the next week, actually, our last message in Hebrews. And so it's been an exciting journey for me, and I hope for you. But we learned clear back in chapter 1, Jesus is better than the angels. He's better than the prophets. He's better than Moses. Jesus is better than the priests and the whole priestly sacrificial system. He is the Savior, the only one who fulfilled the law, and He is the fulfillment of the law. And the law teaches you and shows you that you could never measure up. Only Jesus could do that. And it's only through Him, by Him, because of Him, that you are able to have a relationship with God. Jesus fulfilled all the requirements of the law. And the major factor was that without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness. And so you had the sacrifices over and over and over again throughout the whole Old Testament, and it all pointed to Jesus, who was the single sufficient sacrifice for your sin. The one who could take care of your sin. And He fulfilled that in your place. You and I, we deserve to die. We deserve that our lives be, our blood be shed and die. But He did that for you and for me. He did that in our place, the substitutionary death of Christ. So when we ask the question, well, what fulfills the law, it really comes down to what we just sang about. And that's love. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world." You put your name in there, God so loved you, that if you believe in Him, you would have eternal life because He died for you. He died in your place. And so, as our study in the book of Hebrews draws to a close, how apropos for the reader to be encouraged with this thought. And this is our take-home thought today, and that is, live a life of love. Live a life of love. In Matthew 22, verses 36 to 40, Jesus is asked, "Tell us, what is the greatest commandment?" of all the commandments in the scriptures, what is the greatest commandment? And Jesus said, to love the Lord your God with all your soul, mind, strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. The fulfillment of the law. It comes down to love. So, Jesus even said, when you receive a child in my name, an exercise of demonstration of love. To receive a child in the name of Jesus because of who Jesus is and for all that he stands. Not because of who you are and how good you are because you just love the little ones that come unto you. No, Jesus says you welcome them because of me. You welcome them in my name because of who I am, not because of who you are. And the point there is that there's no good in us apart from Jesus. There's no good in us apart from Jesus. And that's what Hebrews is all about. And that's love for God, who provided salvation for you through Jesus. You know, wow, think about that. You have all of these shadows of Jesus in the Old Testament. You have all of the furnishings in the tabernacle. And all of those, and even the way the tabernacle was set up, it all pointed to salvation through the Messiah, through the Lord Jesus who would one day come. They were all the shadows. You don't even have the ritualistic observance of the Sabbath where you just set aside one day. Because our relationship with God is every day through Jesus Christ. He is our Sabbath rest. It's all found in Jesus. It all points to Jesus. Your eternal rest is found in him. So you focus your life, your every single day upon him out of your love for God and because of your relationship with him through Jesus Christ. So in pulling this together then, the writer's bringing this all down here to some concluding statements. And he says here in chapter 13 and verse 1, let brotherly love continue. Let brotherly love continue. He's really making an appeal for you to live in light of the law of God, the law of love. Love for God, love for one another, which grows out of or because of our love for God. The law was so cherished by the Old Testament Jew, but it was really translated into love, as Jesus said. What's the most important law there? To love God. And as a result of your love for God, to love your neighbor as yourself. So in light of that, then, as he's talked about all of this coming all through the study in Hebrews, he is now going to give you this appeal of love for one another. And then he's going to give you some practical suggestions on how to live that out and how that love for God should affect your love for others. So the appeal is to continue in love. And the idea here is to keep on in that love. There had been an evidence of love, and the writer's appeal to them, because, again, of the context of Hebrews, was that they were tempted to turn and go back. And that's why he says, no, 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 continue in love. Remember your love for God through the Lord Jesus Christ, the love that you experienced by trusting in Christ for your salvation. And as you responded to that love and salvation, trusting Christ for your eternal salvation, now love one another. And let it continue. Don't go back. And so there's an encouragement here that if you're here today and you have not understood that love that God has provided through Jesus Christ, that you would come to Jesus in salvation. Come to God through Jesus Christ in salvation. We had just wonderful testimony of these young ladies who as children, they understood the gospel. It's very simple and to comprehend. Because God worked out all the details, right? The intricacies of all of that, God worked that out. We may not fully understand all of the everything that's behind the backdrop of salvation, but but you can understand that you're a sinner and you need a Savior. That Savior is Jesus, who died, was buried, and rose again. He died because he loves you. And he wants you to have eternal life through him. And so if you're watching, listening, if you're here today to understand that salvation is through Christ and Christ alone, and come to him. Some people think that, well, if I just love other people and do good, then I'll be good. Kind of like that guy thought, you know, when he beat up all the bikers, you know, oh, that ought to get me in. No, I'm sorry. It's not the good that you do. It's what he did for you on the cross. And you believe that that was sufficient payment for you. So the encouragement is for you to come to Jesus. And if you don't understand that or you have questions about that, we want to help you with that. That's the most important ongoing message that we have here at FBC. And we want you to know that, to understand that. And then that you would follow in obedience to baptism, just like these young ladies did. That's a powerful testimony that these young ladies have given to say, I want you to know that I love God. And I believe that he provided that salvation. And I want to be a part of this fellowship. And that's what a part of membership and holding one another accountable to that. The what and who of the gospel, as we call it. But to continue in love and to love each other. To love as brothers. And the word there is from the word from which we get Philadelphia, brotherly love. It was phileo. And it is a brotherly love because we come from the same spiritual Father, Father God. And he's saying, all right, in light of that, here's how you show that brotherly love toward God and toward one another. So let's look at some ways to show love. And the first one here is in verse 2, practice hospitality. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. It's interesting to note that God says don't neglect or don't forget to show hospitality to or to entertain strangers. Now, interestingly, New Testament Christians were to be careful not to obey. In fact, in the Old Testament, he told them not to adopt the ways of foreigners. The Old Testament Jew, they were like, you know, they were to be separate. And even as believers, New Testament, as you come to Jesus, we don't adopt the ways of the world around us, and yet we are in the world, and he says here to entertain strangers, foreigners. And it might seem like God's talking out of both sides of his mouth here. Now, wait a minute. You're telling me, you know, not to adopt their ways, but yet entertain them. How does that come about here? Well, it really comes back to Jesus' teaching. One of the illustrations he gave was the Good Samaritan. Remember when there was the man who was beaten up and the priests and the Levite, they went around over onto the other side and tried to avoid them, right? That individual who was beaten. Wanted to get away from them. And yet the Samaritan was commended by Jesus because he took care of a stranger. And that might cause us to scratch our heads once again in light of the separation issue. And yet, if you think about it, that's what Jesus did for you and me. We were strangers, and he took us in. We were outside, and he brought us in. And so he is the quintessential example of what we're talking about here, the love and showing hospitality to a stranger as he welcomes you in to his family. And as a part of a church, as a part of a church body and a church family, we love our fellowship together. We're having a members meeting But you know, we invite other people to come to those meetings. If you're here and you don't know what that's all about, stay for lunch. And you're going to have people come up to you, and you're going to have people come up talk to you and introduce themselves to you. And we want to get to know you. We want to practice this, what we're saying here, to entertain strangers. And so as an encouragement to you as a member, for those who are members, is to don't just hang out with your friends, all right? Now, I'm not saying don't hear what I'm not saying. I'm not saying don't hang out with your friends. That's not what I'm saying, right? It's good to have friends, but don't hang out exclusively with just your friends, right? Reach out to the people you don't know or don't know well. Reach out to the stranger, to the foreigner, and welcome them in, because that's what you were apart from Christ, and he welcomed you in. And so when we love the Lord our God with everything in us, we're going to love others in this way. We're going to reach out. And so I encourage you to get into the habit. We're not in our culture, we tend not to be in that habit, although sometimes the world does better at this than the church. Because we like our holy huddles, don't we? We like the comfort of, you know, we don't have all of that possible influence coming in at us. But you know what? He says, you know, this is the way you go into the world, and you have an effect on the world around you. Now, other thought about this. It's interesting. And I encourage you to take that to heart. He is pulling all of this together with some very practical suggestions. And you just ask yourself, when's the last time I reached out to somebody I didn't know? When's the last time we had someone over to our house that we didn't know or know well? When did I reach out to them? So I encourage you with that. But another interesting factor here is that when you do this, there are those who have entertained angels. And so, now, the temptation is for you to go, man, I wonder if I've ever done that. Let's see, there's that person I didn't know, and I've never seen him again. I wonder if they were an angel. That's not the point, all right? Don't try to figure out, because if you did, you were unaware of it, right? So, and evidently God doesn't want you to know about it. That's why you were unaware of it, right? And so don't try to figure that out. But the point of the matter is that there have been those who have done that, and maybe you have done that. Don't know. Possible reference back to Abraham and when he had the angels come to him and so on. But the point here is that there have been those who have done that, and maybe you have. You just don't know. In other words, get into the practice and the habit of doing that. And it's a way of showing love. Showing love to strangers. And that's the emphasis here. Not just to one another's, which that's important too, but to strangers. Here's another way to show love. Verse 3. Remember those who are in prison, as though in prison with them, and those who are mistreated, since you also are in the body. So remember those in prison. I believe that the reference is primarily to those who are in prison and suffering for the cause of Christ. That's the context of Hebrews, because they were being persecuted for their turning to Jesus. And in that persecution, were tempted to go back to the Old Testament ways. And some of them were imprisoned for their faith. You read about some of that in chapter 11. I think the encouragement here, it's difficult to talk about those who are in prison in our culture for the cause of Christ, because we don't see that here very often. It may come to that one day with all that's going on in our culture right now. And we have a missionary, Jack Jung, Jack Jung in South Korea, who loves his people in North Korea. And he encouraged us to make sure that we pray for the Christians in North Korea. There are people all around the world who are persecuted for their faith, are imprisoned for their faith, are beaten and mocked and imprisoned because of faith, their faith. We need to pray for them, to have a heart for them, remember them, as he says. And I think that's a great way to remember them. One of the statements that was made, I believe Jack is the one who said this, is that the concern of many around the world is that the Christians in America have become soft because of the lack of persecution. And you know as well as I do, in order to be strengthened, that sometimes we have to go through the challenges and difficulties. So again, I think we're naive to think that our generation is going to get away without some persecution of some sort. With that challenge to remember those who are persecuted and are in prison because of their faith. If we face persecution as a church, let's say I was arrested. Not better yet, let's say Pastor Nate was arrested. What would be important to us? What would be important to you? One of our goals here this year as pastors is that we minimize preferences and maximize the gospel. And I just wonder if the temperature of the building would be that important to us. And let's say because of our stand for Christ, electricity and gas was turned off. You know, you can't pay your bill. We won't accept your money. We're cutting you off. What would we still come and attend? Would you still want to gather and worship? And so whatever, and again, we're just thinking this through, but think through what would be important to you if we were persecuted here at First Baptist Church. And what we want to do is we want to maximize the gospel and the Lord Jesus and minimize our preferences. I'm not saying we don't have preferences. But I'm just saying that if or when persecution would come, what would be most important? And I believe it would be Jesus and the gospel. Because there are those around the world who don't have what we have. They're imprisoned for their faith, persecuted for the gospel. And that should be our focus even now. Here's another way to show love. Verse 4. Let marriage be held in honor among all. And let the marriage bed be undefiled, for God will judge the sexually immoral and adulterous. The third way to show love is to honor marriage. Now, there's enough in this verse for another sermon series, but we won't go there right now. But we live in a day and age when we need this verse. There are ways in which marriage is not honored. And you can think of them. I don't have to go into a lot of details, but there are couples who live together for years before they get married. That doesn't honor marriage. Divorce is unbelievably common. Sex before marriage or outside of marriage is accepted. And here's another way. And again, I want to be careful here, but I even think that the attitude of, well, you know, wait for a long time before you get married. I looked up, there's some varying statistics on this, but the Office of National Statistics for 2020 said that the average age for women to get married right now is 35, and the average age for men is 38. Why are we waiting so long? Well, I looked at another website. It's called thenot.com. And they said, societal behavioral patterns, evolving workforce, and a stronger sense of self-sufficiency are reasons why people are waiting longer to get married. I think there are a lot who don't want to make commitment. They don't want to make a commitment. They don't want to be tied down. They want to have the freedom to change their mind. And some want to save up so that marriage will be easier. So they live together and to see if it's going to work out. And then if they think it's going to work out and they've saved up enough money, then they'll get married. Those are maybe some factors. Sex before marriage is common, so there's not the quote-unquote need to get married. So those are the attitudes, I think, that are coming out about this. But I think even those who are married need to be cautioned not to take marriage for granted, to continue to date one another, to enjoy one another's company, to speak well of each other. It really concerns me when, you know, a guy says, "Oh yeah, I got to check with the wife," or the wife says, "Well, the old man's going to be home soon," you know. And those are kinds of things that kind of erode. They just don't show honor for marriage. But the point here is to honor marriage. Marriage needs a renewed sense of awe in our culture, in our mind, in our way of thinking. It is to be held, the word honor here is to be held as of great price, to be esteemed, especially dear to us. Marriage, we ought to have that idea of marriage, to have the mystique of marriage. Weddings should be a worship service of celebration, and we should rejoice in those 25-year, 30, 40, 50, 60, and beyond anniversaries. You know, we just say, man, what a testimony as to faithfulness to one another, and even a testimony to the faithfulness of God in that marriage. That's a way to honor marriage. Marriage it's a big deal. And the marriage bed, it goes on to say, is to be undefiled. It is to be kept pure. The phrase marriage bed here in the Greek is a word for the physical relationship. The physical relationship is to be kept undefiled. And the way to do that is to keep sex for marriage and marriage alone. That's what sex is for. Any expression of sexual expression outside of marriage is sin. That's the way God designed it. And so you keep it in the marriage and marriage alone. I was talking to a couple just recently, and I said, you know, it's just... One way that helps me think of this is that the physical relationship is God's wedding gift to the couple. And it should be treasured, it should be cherished by that couple, and that's why outside of marriage, sexual expression is sin. And he says that God will judge the sexually immoral and adulterous. He doesn't go into great detail, doesn't have to. Marriage or not marriage. Marriage, there's blessing and freedom. Outside of marriage, there's judgment for sexual expression. God is judge. It's a way of showing love. It's a way in which we show love for God and one another is by honoring marriage. Here's another way. Verses 5 and 6. Keep your life free from the love of money and be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be content. Be content. Now you say, well, what does that have to do with love? Well, who are you thinking about when you're discontent? Self, right? When you're discontent, you're thinking about yourself. And so to be content means to think that you're thinking beyond yourself to God and others. Understand through this and believe that God is with you. Understand and believe that God is with you. He says here, I will never leave you. Guys who are men of faith, here's that little nugget I was telling you. This is a double negative in the Greek. He is saying, I will never leave you. He's emphasizing it here. He says, I will never, ever, not at all, in no case, cease to sustain you and uphold you. I will not let you sink. I will not desert you or leave you. He goes on to say, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will not leave you helpless or destitute, defeated, or left in the middle of a hostile situation. God will come to your rescue. He may come to you in the middle of that desperate situation and help you as you go through it, or he may, by his choice, take you out from that. But he is with you. I will never leave you. I'll take you through it. I'll be with you through it. So whatever your situation is, and we all go through them, but some of you are going through some deep, deep waters. You're going through some difficulties, some like you've never gone through before. Take heart. And it would be easy to say, well, just be content. But the point here is, whatever your situation is, that you can be content because God's with you. He's with you through it all. And as we look to our seminar coming up on God's thoughts on your thinking, this is you'll hear this again during that. But we have been through so much over this past year, and so many changes. We need this. Because I touched on this last week. We tend to want to go back, don't we? We want to, if it was just BC, before COVID, right? If we could just go back to the way it was and everything would just get normal, man, it'd be great. Just can't wait. But you know what? It may not get that way. There may be even greater pressures on us. You could just think through the possibilities. I don't spend a lot of time there because I don't know. We don't know what that could happen. But we need this right here. We be content, because Jesus says, I will never, never leave you. Never. Nor will I forsake you. I'll be with you in it and through it. So, verse 6, we can confidently say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? Wow. You know, talk about confidence in the middle of whatever desperate situation in which you find yourself. It's like, I don't have to fear. God is with me. What can man do to me? He's my helper. Philippians 4:6, you know, be anxious for nothing. Don't worry about anything. In Matthew chapter 6, Jesus says, God feeds the birds and clothes the flowers. They don't worry about it, right? And so why do you and I worry about it when we have a relationship with God? If you don't have a relationship with God through Jesus, you have every reason to worry. Right? But if you do, no worries. No reason to fear. What could man do to you? The worst that he could do is kill you. And if that happens, guess what? Absent from the body, present with the Lord. Amen. Do you believe it? Amen. Let's live like it. Let's live like it. Right? So be content. And here's a fifth way to show love. And he says, remember your leaders. Interesting that he says, remember your leaders. Why would he say remember them? Well, I think, again, in the context that some of them may have been martyred. They may not be with them any longer. So remember them. Those who spoke the word of God, spoke to you the word of God, consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Be mindful of your leaders. That's a reference again to persecution that they faced and the spiritual leaders faced. And it was the unique pressure due to their position. Oftentimes, if there's persecution in the church, it's a pastor that is the one who suffers the persecution or gets arrested first. He's the leader. So remember their faith. Remember their walk and imitate them. I think even in our cultural context, pastors experience some unique challenges or pressures. I've heard more than one person say, you know what, I wouldn't want your job. I wouldn't want your job. Well, what they're saying is, with all that goes with the job, they wouldn't want to go through that. And so remember them in that way and follow their example. Not that your pastors are perfect. Pastor Nate and I were reading a book called Lead. And I told Pastor Nate, I don't like the book. It just stomps all over my toes. I just don't care for that. But it has challenged me to realize I'm not all that I think I am. You know, I need to be humbled before the Lord, but humbled before you. And this ministry is not about me. It's about you and one another as we care for one another. It's not about how good I look or how good I come across to you in my preaching or teaching. Am I being faithful to point you to Christ in the gospel? That's what matters. And so it's not my ministry. It's our ministry. It's the ministry that we share. And so your pastors, Pastor Doug, Pastor Nate, we're not perfect. But as Paul says to Timothy, and then he says to the Corinthians church, follow me as I follow the example of Christ. To the extent that I do walk in obedience to the Lord, follow that example. So there's that element there. And the phrase means, literally, to remember with a view to obeying your pastor's biblical direction. Not saying that pastors are perfect, but remember their instruction. And that's my commitment, is to be faithful to the Word of God. I hope you see that when you come, and I hope you know and anticipate that when you come to FBC on Sunday mornings, you are going to hear from God. It's not about, I wonder what Pastor Dale has to say to us. That's not the issue. It's what does God have to say? And so that's why we're committed. If you cease to hear from the Word of God, from this pulpit and through this ministry, get rid of us. Just get rid of us. Because that's, you need to hear from God, not from me, or Pastor Nate, or Pastor Doug. Let's hear from God. So come with that heart of anticipation. And I think remembering your spiritual leaders involves listening to and putting into practice the teaching of the Word of God, to hear what God has to say as we minister the Word of God to you. I think remembering them has the aspect of loving and caring for your leaders. And I thank you for that love and care that you have expressed. From the bottom of my heart, you've been faithful to support me and my family, the other pastors, and we thank you for that. But I think the greatest way that you can remember your leaders, I ask you to do this, and that is pray for us. I think that's the greatest thing you can do. Pray often for your pastors and your spiritual leaders. So as you think about all of these things, what area that we have discussed needs your attention? You might say, well, I need to grow in all of them. That's good. But the point here is to replace a focus upon self and live a life of love. Because we tend to think that this life is all about us. And I just so appreciate that about the writer of Hebrews as God worked here and superintended to record these truths for us, to bring this down to the fact with all of the doctrinal thoughts that we've waded through throughout this book, he's come down and he says, you know what? Just in closing, I just want you to know, love God. Love God with everything in you. As God has loved you, love others. Serve Him, serve the Lord out of a grateful heart for what He's done, and you can do that by practicing hospitality, by remembering those in prison, by honoring marriage, by being content, and remembering your spiritual leaders. Very practical. I trust you're encouraged by these things. Take one, if not all of them, but at least take one and say, you know what? I'm going to grow in that area. I'm just going to really focus in on that this next week, this next month, in the months ahead. And ask God, cry out to God, and say, God, how can you help me grow in these areas? And just be attentive to that. Do some more study on that as to God could, how He could help you with that. There's much in His Word. I've said more than once in this message. There's a whole series that could be preached on each of these. Take them to heart. Let's ask for God's help. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for your Word. Your Word is truth. And I thank you that you have instructed us here even now. Again, may I be reminded it's not what I say that's important. It's what you have said. And I'm just a mere instrument in your hands to communicate your word. And Father, I pray that each heart here would be in tune with what you have for them today. And I pray that we would all be faithful, that we would be faithful in our love for you, to love you with everything in us, that our love for you wouldn't be restricted to just one day, coming to church on Sundays, but that our love for you would be evident day after day after day. And that we would be faithful as we live out these truths, reaching out to strangers. We're so thankful that we were strangers and you took us in. And so may we have that same spirit, that same attitude, to guard against the influences of the world, of course, but to reach out to show the love of Jesus, your love to the world around us, in whatever context we find ourselves. So with heads bowed and eyes closed, I hope, I trust, I pray that you have been open to what God has for you today through His Word. His Word is living, it's powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, as we learned back in chapter 4. And I just ask you to take to heart these truths. And I encourage everyone to fill out a connection card. We have those at the doors here. And if you fill out a card here, you can place it in the offering receptacle. And again, thank you for your faithful giving. That is a way in which you have remembered your pastors, that we are supported through this ministry, and thank you for your faithfulness. But it goes beyond that to our ministry, not only here in Troy, but around the world. That's how we support our missionaries. Thank you for remembering them in this way. You can also fill out a connection card on YouVersion through our website and through our new digital bulletin. And you can fill out a connection card there, and you can also give electronically as well. But again, jot down there how God has spoken to you through His Word and the commitment that you may be making here today in light of these very practical suggestions and encouragements. And if you've chosen one through which you'd like to be growing, we'd like to know what that is. If you're here today and you're not certain of salvation, we want to help you with that. Mark that down too. Someone just told me earlier they want to join the church. I said, mark it down on your card. We'll get with you. If you'd like to join with us, do that. And we just praise God for this opportunity to respond to the ministry of his word. So, Father, help us now as we prepare our hearts for communion. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood
And that's how we come to the Lord as we celebrate communion together. Again, what a blessing to do this as a family united here. We think of the ordinances as being significant, a significant part of the church. Pastor Nate's going to be talking about this a little bit during our members' meeting. But this shows that both the ordinances show the what and the who of the gospel. And here we have a vivid visual illustration of what the gospel is. And that's that Jesus Christ died, was buried, and rose again, represented through the bread that represents and symbolizes his broken body and the juice that symbolizes his shed blood. And so we have these pictures here that point us to Jesus. And these are the pictures that he's given to us in the New Testament. So as we think of the what and the who of the gospel, that's the what, but the who is those who are part of the body. And as those who have been identified, we have the baptism as being part of the church. And you may not be a part of this church, but we believe in a close communion. Some churches believe in a closed communion, only those who are members of the church. We believe in close. If you have trusted Christ as Savior, and you're certain of that salvation through Jesus Christ, we invite you to commune with us together. He says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 27, whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. And so the examination is, first of all, are you certain of salvation through Jesus? If you're not sure, it would be better for you to just wait and get that settled. But if you are sure, we invite you to commune with us, but there's another point of examination. And is there any known unconfessed sin that needs to be settled before the Lord? And the point here is to get that settled. Settle that now. And then when you do that, let's celebrate together. Focus on the Lord. One way to do that is while the elements are being passed is to read a passage of Scripture. I might suggest Isaiah chapter 53. If you know the songs that are being played, you can think through the words of those songs. But again, this is not the time to let your mind just wander wherever, but a time to focus on the Lord. So we'd like to, first of all, have a moment of silent prayer, and then I'll ask Andy Running to ask a blessing on the bread.
Dear Father, we thank you for your love that was shown to us in such a graphic way by your death on the cross. We thank you for your body that this represents. But we also pray, as Pastor shared with us here today, that we can show that love in our own ways as we go throughout our life here. We thank you for that blessing and pray that you would bless it and us in the days ahead. Amen.
And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." I'll ask Dal Donnelly to ask the blessing on the cup.
Dear Lord, for time as this, you've brought us here so that we can, so that I can confess the sins of the body and your spilled blood. We ask you be with us as we remember those that we have hurt, and that we might ask forgiveness of them as we ask forgiveness from you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We want you to know that if you have questions about any of the matters which we've discussed here today, we want to talk to you. We want to help you. I'll be available after the service, and we'd love to get with you concerning these things. Let's stand together as we sing.
This morning, for your word, for the book of Hebrews to help us. We thank you that you take us just as we are. We thank you that you make us new. We are new creations. Old things are past. Behold, all things have become new. And so I pray that your spirit might have freedom among us, that you might affect us, that you might help us to love, that you might help us to obey, that you might help us to have strong marriages. All of these things that we have commanded, I pray that you might come alongside and help and enable. So we turn to this coming week and we pray for your blessing. And I pray that you might bring us all back next Sunday to worship you together in Jesus' name.